Good morning, everyone. We're going to start with a prelude called Up and Up by Coldplay.
Fixing up a car to driving it again. Searching for the water, hoping for the rain. Up and up, up and up. Down upon a canvas, working meal to meal. Waiting for a chance to pick your orange field. Up and up, up and up.
Join us as we sing the song on page 55. Fill us with your love.
Feet of his
next song is on page 151, See the Savior in the Temple.
The Lord said, in the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. Amen. O come, let us worship and bow down, let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. Lord, you have given us the promise of eternal life. Each one of us will live forever. And you give us teachings in your word which show us what the quality of that life can be like based on the choices we make, what we love, what we care about, how we live. Lord, help us to think about those choices and try to make better choices that are in line with love and caring and wisdom. And Lord, comfort us at the loss of those we know that are not in this world anymore, but in your kingdom. Bring us comfort and the trust that you're caring for them and they are living as you promised. Thank you, Lord, for these promises and for your hope. Amen. Our Father, who art in the heavens, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as in heaven, so upon the earth. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. O Lord, forgive us our trespasses. Amen. I invite you all to be seated, and children, I invite you to come forward if you'd like to do that for your talk. Morning, Atticus. Good to see you. All right, come on up. Come on up if you're coming. Hi, guys. So I want to tell you a story this morning about an amazing thing that happened. Hi, guys. I'm going that side? All right.
I want this side.
All right.
I want my brother to be.
Your brother to be next to? Okay. Good morning. Well, there's an amazing story in the Lord's Word about a man named Lazarus. And Lazarus had sisters named Mary and Martha, which you read about in other parts of the Word. But Lazarus was a friend, and so was Mary and Martha, of Jesus. They were friends together, and he knew them very well. They knew him. And Jesus was far away from where Lazarus lived, and it turned out one day that the Lord found out that Lazarus had died. So he went to see him, went to be there. And Mary and Martha came out and said, if you had been here, he would not have died. And the Lord did something amazing. Do you know what the Lord did in this story? Do you remember the story? Can you guess what would have been an amazing thing to do? Yeah.
Make them live again?
Yeah, he brought them back to life. You believe that?
No.
4 days after he had died, he brought them back to life. He was already in the tomb, already wrapped up in grave clothes, and he walked out and was alive again.
Weird.
It's amazing, isn't that?
Yeah,
a little bit. So let's read what that's about that story, okay? Now, a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. So the sister sent word to Jesus, "Lord, the one you love is sick." When he heard this, Jesus said, "This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." Now, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days, and then he said to his disciples, "Let us go back to Judea. Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to wake him up." His disciples replied, "Lord, if he sleeps, he will get better." Jesus had been speaking of his death, but his disciples thought he meant natural sleep. So then he told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead, and for your sake I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him. But Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." But Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me will live even if they die, and those who live and believe in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she replied. "I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who has come into the world." Now, as the story went on, Jesus went there and he called Lazarus forth, said, "Lazarus, come forth," and he came forth out of the tomb, and they took the grave clothes off him, and he was fine. So this story is about life after death. Each one of us will live a life in this world, in this body, right? But is this body going to live forever? No, it's not. It's going to die. But we are going to live forever, who we are, what we love, our spirit, our mind. The way I like to think about it is kind of like a hand in a glove. So what's real, or what's the most important part of this, my hand or the glove?
The hand.
The hand, right? The hand's making the glove move, isn't it? Mm-hmm. So it's like your body is moving because your soul, your spirit that the Lord's given you is inside, is living through us. So at some point, this glove, well, I have a different glove I'm going to put on. At some point, the glove might not be able to function anymore, like kind of falling apart, right?
Yeah.
Kind of what it feels like when you get old, like me, start to fall apart, things start to not work anymore. And at some point, it doesn't work anymore, and it won't act as a glove. Like, would this work very well if it was cold outside? No, my probably
it
hand would.
Cold outside.
Well, my hand would get cold. So at some point, we don't use it anymore, but we live on after death. So we live forever. Maybe you've noticed that the Lord gives us lots of different signs about that in the world. Like right now, what's happening all around us in the earth? Have you noticed something happening in the trees and the ground? Yeah. Things are blooming, right? Things that looked like they were dead.
Flowers?
Flowers are coming up out of the ground, exactly.
And trees are starting out leaves again.
Yeah, exactly.
Picking flowers.
You're already picking flowers that came up out of the ground. So the Lord gives us and flowers. So the Lord shows us all around us, like every day there's a reminder that, you know, at night the day starts to get bright. Like this morning the sun came up, it was a brand new day, it's bright, it starts to get dark, and then it becomes nighttime, right? It feels like that day just died. We're never going to see the sun again. But what happens the next day?
The sun comes up.
The sun comes up, and we see that again. Or we have winter, and it seems like everything in our hemisphere dies, right? You look outside, like I have this. What else do I have under here? We have this. Does that look pretty unhappy?
Like
doesn't look very much alive, does it?
Yeah.
So you could say, well, it's dead, but it's something off the same branch is starting to do something. What is it doing? blooming, right? It's bringing new life. So every year that happens for us, right? We think, oh no, everything died. But it comes again.
That's still growing.
It's still growing. Well, I have something. This is interesting. So this is a piece of meat that's been in a jar for 4 days. What do you think's happening to that meat?
Yuck.
Rotting, right?
Yeah, yuck.
So Lazarus, he was dead for 4 days, and they said, the story goes on to talk about, there's already a smell. They can already smell, because bodies start to smell after, or if you've maybe been near a dead squirrel or something, it starts to smell pretty bad. So I thought, well, what would happen if we took a piece of meat and stuck it in a jar for 4 days? Should we open it and smell, or should we just let it sit in there?
Open it.
Open it?
All
right, well,
don't open it.
I'm opening it. If you don't want to smell it, you don't have to. Who wants to smell it first? You do? Tell me if it smells all right. You don't see his face. It's not a good, he doesn't look happy. Yeah.
I can smell it.
You want to smell it? So imagine, yeah. You want to smell it? Okay. Well, this just makes the story even more amazing because Lazarus was dead for 4 days and he was stuck in a cave, wrapped up, and there was already a smell. But Jesus made him come back to life. An amazing story about the Lord's power to help us in our life, to help us with things we're dealing with, things we're sadness, or he's promised us too that we will live after death. So the body at some point won't work anymore, but each one of us will live forever. So our job here is to try to make the right kind of decisions that help us to be happy, help us be useful, be loving and kind, right? So that's what we're trying to learn. Love is good. Do you have any questions about that story? Or anything that we talked about? All right, let's go sing our next song. Thank you. You're all done with that? Nope.
All right, please stand as we sing the song Heal Me on page 68.
Freely we have received, freely we give. I invite you to bow your heads for a blessing on the children. May the Lord give his angels charge over you to keep you in all of your ways. Amen. I invite the children and the teens to go to their programs, and we'll sing our next song.
That is Return the Love on page 145.
Reading will be shared by Doug Hunt.
So this is from John chapter 11, selected portions. After she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. "The teacher is here," she said, "and is asking for you." When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come among her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. "Take away the stone," he said. "But Lord," said Martha, the sister of the dead man, "by this time there is a stench, for he has been there 4 days." Then Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, "Take off the grave clothes and let him go."
Thank you. Our next couple of readings are from the Heavenly Doctrine for the New Church and various teachings on the afterlife. "For when we die, we do not really die. We merely lay aside the body that has served us for our use in the world and pass into the next life in a body which serves us for our use there. Those that are in heaven are continually advancing towards the spring of life, with a greater advance towards a more joyful and happy spring, the more thousands of years they live, and this to eternity, with increase according to the growth and degree of their love, charity, and faith. In a word, to grow old in heaven is to grow young. All spirits, as soon as they enter the other life, are recognized by their friends, their relatives, and acquaintances, and afterward they talk to each other and mingle together, just as they used to do in the world. After death, we enjoy every sense, memory, thought, and affection we had in the world. We leave nothing behind except our earthly body. We see the way we used to. We hear and talk the way we used to. We smell and taste and feel things, and when we touch them the way we used to. We want, we wish, crave, think, ponder, are moved, love, and intend the way we used to. Studious types still read and write as before. In a word, when we move from the one life into the other, or from the one world into the other, it is like moving from one physical place to another. Amen. Here end our lessons, and blessed are they who hear the word of God and keep it. Amen.
Spend all your time waiting for that second chance, for the break that will make it okay. There's always some reason to feel not good enough, and it's hard at the end of the day. I need some distraction. Seep from my veins. They may be straight line, and everywhere you turn, there's vultures and thieves at your back. The storm keeps on twisting, you keep on building the lies that you make up for all that you lack. It don't make no difference, escaping one last time, it's easier to believe in this sweet madness. Oh, this glorious sadness that brings me to my knees in the arms of the angel. Fly away from here, from this dark, cold hotel room, and the endlessness that you feel. You are pulled from the wreckage of your silent reverie in the arms of the angel. May you find some comfort here. You're in the arms of the angel. May you find some comfort here.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. So a few years ago, I had surgery on my knee and shoulder. And part of what they do when you're old like me is they require a chest x-ray or an EKG to make sure that you can handle the surgery. And so that took place in the morning, and later that night they gave me a call and say they want to do a follow-up CT scan. And they said there is an abnormality in your upper right lobe of your lung. So what do you think I did with that information? Worried, right? First thing. And what you need to worry properly is a little bit of information like that and a way to find out more information to feed the concern that you have because you only have little information, and that's what the internet is for. So the obvious thing that I found was, well, cancer, lung cancer, and it said that lung cancer is very aggressive. And I thought to myself, well, I don't have any symptoms. And then I looked up a little further that 25% of people don't have any symptoms. So I had 2 days to think about that because I had 2 days before I had to go in for a pre-surgery prep. So I didn't sleep much, I thought a lot, I worried a lot. When you're faced with your immortality, as I imagine, whether it's real or imaginary, you think about a lot of things. And I wasn't okay with my life. I've had more regrets about it than I anticipated. I felt like I could have been more loving, more generous to the various people in my life, more useful, more patient, those sorts of things. And the sadness about the possibility that this was going to be the beginning of the end of my life. So I went in there and checked the CT scan, and it was perfectly fine. So, which is nice. But you get those experiences, and you have a chance to think about things like that. So one of the topics that Easter brings up naturally for us is the afterlife and what happens to us when we die. And how do you feel personally about the idea of being confronted with death? Have you given that much thought? Is there an afterlife? Do you believe in an afterlife? Is it real? Is it something that It's imaginary that people made up. I think sometimes people have a hard time thinking about or imagining the afterlife when they think about it scientifically, like, all right, where's the proof, where's the evidence that we can look at and really get into the facts that there is life after death? But I think we think about it or feel about it emotionally, like in our gut. We know that the people we love that have passed on are still alive. We know that they are on some level and that we will see them again and that we will live. Because if there is a God that created us and it's amazing life that we have and the amazing relationships we have and the feelings that we feel, why would that just be something so temporal and so limited? Because it's love that lasts forever. It's those connections that we have with each other. Our bodies will certainly die, but our love for one another does not die. It lives on in our spirit. It lives on in our true selves. But you don't need your body to go anywhere. Think about that here, right now. Some of you might have already done this. You've already gone and thought about what you're doing later today, or you went thought about, did I turn the stove off? Or, sorry, I shouldn't say that. Now you're wondering about it. But you can sit in this room, and you can travel off into faraway places. You can be with someone who's not even here. We can be connected with them. Because we, our spirits, what are bound by this body, but this body will not be here forever. So we are created, we're told, by the Lord for a purpose, and it's an eternal purpose. And that purpose is that there might be a heaven from the human race. And when I say that, I don't want you to think about that as evacuation theology, which means that the goal is just to get everybody off the planet into heaven. It's like, no, that's not the point. The point is to live our life that the Lord has given us, and we know that we create our own heaven and hell within us by the life that we're leading, by the choices that we make. You've probably experienced those different states where you might say, you know, I'm going through hell right now, or I've been in hell, or I'm really enjoying myself. I'm having a wonderful state. I feel like I'm really connected. I feel great love for other people. But the Lord creates us so that we may live forever of being able to love other people, be useful, and enjoy our lives. The heavenly doctrines say every person is created that he or she may live forever in a state of happiness. So if the Lord's goal is that we may live forever in a state of happiness, that's good to remember when we are unhappy, that the Lord's goal is actually that we might be happy, and not just for a moment, but forever. And he doesn't say that my goal is that you might be happy in this world. This is the goal, but this is a place to experience things, to get to and through to the goal. Now, has there ever been a time in your life when you've been doing something that you love to do and time doesn't exist and you have great joy because you're helping somebody else, you're being useful in a way that is just delightful? And that's a little bit of a taste of what heaven is like, doing things for other people without thought of reward and the joy we get and the delight we get from that. That's the kind of excitement that angels feel, the joy that they feel. And the Lord wants us to feel that forever. I love this little passage from the Divine Providence that says, everyone who comes into heaven comes into the greatest joy of their heart. So you think about someone who you love who has passed on, and you know we have that deep loss of losing someone here, but knowing that they are entering into the greatest joy of their heart, what it is that makes them the most happy on the deepest level. So what is death? Well, death is what happens when the body can no longer correspond to the uses of the spirit. As we talked about with the example of the glove, it's no longer serving the use of a glove, so it is discarded. And the heaven and hell says, but the person does not die in that instance. He or she is merely separated from the bodily part that was of use to him or her in the world. So that part is separated, but that inner part, that spirit, lives on. Now, I'm guessing that each one of us has lost someone who's close to us, someone that we love, be it a partner, be it a child, be it a grandparent, friend, whatever that is. You think about that as, wow, that's such a hard experience. In the natural world that we're living in, it's so final feeling. It seems so ending, like there's no hope for tomorrow. But the Lord promises that that's not the end of the story. There is promise. There is life eternal. But But it's so hard. In this natural world, it does feel so final. So if you've experienced those losses, how are you dealing with that? How are you experiencing that? How are you living with that loss? I think it's important to say that when someone dies, it's not something that we get over. I think people like to talk about it as, well, when you get over the loss of that person. And that's just the wrong verbiage to use around it. It's not getting over it, it's learning to live with it. We learn to adjust ourselves, or adjust the way that we live. So don't think of it in terms of, well, I've got to get over this. Like, no, you don't. You need to learn to live with that and recognize the sadness and loss of it. I've studied grief a little bit, and some of the things that I remember about it is that there's no right way to grieve. And I think that's important to say as well, that people will say, is this normal? I'm experiencing this. Like, well, there is really no normal when it comes to grief. Everything is kind of part of the normal spectrum. So if you feel like you're going crazy, is that normal? Well, sure, that's part of it. If I'm not feeling sad right now, that's normal too. That's part of it. Grief is very has a great variety within it. And there's a process around it. It's a process of working through it. But when we think about people that have left this world that we love, the thing to remember is that they are alive, that they are well, and they are happy. They are the greatest joy of their heart. And you know, sometimes it's hard to reconcile that, what if half of what makes them so happy is still in this world, right? Although I think what's interesting about the other world is there's no time and space in that world. So we think about someone who has to wait for 30 years till I die so I can be with them. Well, for them, they're not waiting because it's not about time. It's not about space. They are living the greatest joy of their heart, probably preparing for the time, and they probably have a very different perspective than we have in this world where it seems so final, and they can go, yeah, I know you're sad, and I'm here, I'm doing fine, I'm doing well, and I can't wait to see you. Think about the story of Lazarus. It's such a powerful story. I think in one sense you could just read that story and just say, well, amen. That's a good story for today. Talk about the Lord's power. It's the last story of our series on miracles. One of the things that we gather from that story is that the Lord has the power to lift us up. He says, I am the resurrection and the life. It's also a story about how good things in us that may be sick or that we might be losing or that we might be struggling with, how they can be lifted up by the Lord or changed within us. I like what Mary and Martha both say to the Lord. You know, if you had been here, he wouldn't have died. Think about that in terms of our own life. If the Lord is the center of things, if the Lord is present within us, then the love we have or the things we're striving for won't die. The Lord can revive it no matter how dead and stinking it might be. As the story says, you know, well, he's going to remove the stone from the tomb. He says, don't do that. That's already a stench. He's been in there for 4 days. You might think, well, I don't know how I'm going to get through this. This thing I'm dealing with is so dead. I feel so lifeless. Or this relationship is so dead. It's so lifeless. But if the Lord is there, it won't die, or it can be brought back to life. And the caveat I say with that, if we're talking about a relationship, is it takes two people that really want that relationship to work. Not just one person. It takes two people that are invested in that. So no matter how dead that part of you might feel, know the Lord has the power to change your life, change your heart, to resurrect it, to bring it back to life. And it's a process. It's a process. It takes time. The Lord can give you passion for your spiritual life, can give you an interest in helping people. If you just don't have that interest, take the steps. The Lord can help us to feel alive, feel happy, feel useful. And sometimes we blame the Lord and say, hey, it's your fault. If you'd been here, nothing bad would have happened. You know, and we sometimes wonder, well, Lord, I live right. I try to do the right things. I help out. I go to church. But it's still not working. If you had been here, this would never have happened, or I wouldn't be in this state. Now, is that blame on the part of Mary, or is it really too late? Like, part of it is really trusting that if I do the things the Lord tells me to do, that it will change. And I know I'm probably like you. I think, well, if I did it once, then the change is ready. It's good. I should be happy. I should be rid of this thing. If I shun this particular evil once, we're good to go. But it seems to keep cycling back. But recognizing, keep doing it. Keep doing it. Just like if you exercise, you know, people get discouraged from exercising because, you know, you go, you work out in the gym, and you go home, and you look at yourself. You look the same. All right, that didn't work. Should I give it up? Well, I'll go back again and do it again. And it seems like the muscle's just pushing the fat out, so it seems bigger and larger than it was before. So when's that going to start to shed? It's like, well, you just got to keep consistently doing it over and over and over. And the same thing is true of our spiritual life. We have to do it consistently over and over, trusting that change will occur. Well, an interesting thing that Jesus says in the story, too, is that you know, he kind of hesitates to go to Lazarus because he's kind of waiting for him to die so that he can go and resurrect him. And he's like, I didn't go there. I wanted you to see something. I didn't go for your sake. I'm glad that I wasn't there for your sake so you could see something happen. It's an opportunity for us. And I think when we think about the difficult times in our life, think about them as opportunities to really see something wonderful happen. And it's not that the Lord is callous either, because it's beautiful in the story. The Lord shows up and Lazarus is dead and he weeps about it. He loves him. He loves us. He's moved by our grief. He knows that it's hard being human in this worldly experience. And so the Lord weeps, recognizing that. But he also is like, I'm going to do something for you that's so amazing that you will hardly believe it. Did I not say to you, if you believed, you would see the glory of God? And then he brings him back to light. So are we willing to believe in this? Are we believe the Lord can change us from dead to alive? This passage from the Heavenly Doctrine says, the purpose of all regeneration, therefore, is that a person may receive new life, or rather that he or she may receive life, and from not being human may become truly human, that is, from being dead may become alive. Consequently, the regenerate person, someone who's grown spiritually, is a living person, while the unregenerate person is a dead person. So the Lord is changing us from being really truly dead spiritually to alive. Another passage says, before a person can know what truth is or be moved by good, the things that hinder and offer resistance must be removed. Thus, the old self or the old person must die before the new one can be conceived. So the part of us that is dead, that needs to be brought back to life. So what are the things within ourselves, the mindsets, the attitudes, the behaviors? What is the work of our life? And are we willing to change those things? That's the question the Lord offers to us. So I want to ask you to think about for yourself, what are you grieving over? What are you working on? What are you struggling with? Can you go to the Lord and say, I believe in you. Will you help this to change? Will you help me to change? I mean, Easter's coming up, another example of the Lord's great power to bring back to life. So our eternity is now. Forget your past. Forget the errors of your past. They don't define who you are. What defines you is where you're going to go from here. The Lord says, I don't think about where you've been. I think about where you're going. I think about what's your aim, where are you heading. So what are we trying to accomplish? I mean, all of us have made mistakes in our life, and that's not what the Lord focuses on. He focuses on what are you trying to do from here. So eternity is now. It's every moment. How will we shape it? What choices will we make? Who will you create with the life the Lord's given you? Amen. We bow our heads for a prayer. Lord, thank you for the story of the resurrection of Lazarus, showing us the great power you have over our lives, the power to heal us, the power to lift us up, to mend broken relationships, to mend heartaches, and the promise that your life that you've given us is eternal, that those who we love we will see again, and that when we leave this earthly body behind, that we will go on living in a wonderful world where we can find our greatest happiness. Thank you, Lord. Amen. I'd like to open the floor if you have any prayer requests that you would like to ask. We'll have a minute of silent prayer following those requests. Anyone you're thinking about? Yes.
In a few hours, there's going to be a rocket launch in Canaveral. And if it goes well, and the rocket boosters come back okay, then Doug's launch, which he has been anticipating for some years, can take place in June. So I just thought it would be a novel thing to ask us to pray for a couple of rocket boosters.
Okay. Pray for a successful rocket boost. Is that what you said?
They have to come back.
Okay. All right. So be specific about your prayer. Thank you. Lisa?
My aunt Tony.
Aunt Tony?
My aunt Darlene.
Okay. Thank you. Yes? Thank you. Prayers for Susan Todd. Thank you. Yeah. Yeah, a big prayer for those suffering from addiction, too. Thank you for those. Appreciate it. Anyone else? I mentioned Robert Brooks passed away a week ago or so ago and did his memorial service yesterday. So prayers for his son, Colton, and his co-parent. They're not married anymore, Mary, who you might remember, and his girlfriend, Suzanne, who are all part of that family. So prayers for them. Anybody else? Yeah.
My brother-in-law, Mark, just got called onto a high-stress sort of rescue mission for his job, which he's doing software work tomorrow.
Okay.
He's been working over the weekend. Wish him clarity and
tact. Okay, prayers for Mark for what he's working through. Thank you. All right. That it? Let's have a minute of silent prayer. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Will you stand if you're able for the closing of the word?
Please remain standing for our last song, I Love the Lord, on page 81.